So I had to build a, we had to do the insulation around that one particular piece to make sure that it would fit in and what was going to happen with it. But it was just amazing your passion and dedication in doing that. So can you address that a little bit?
Yes, and even I wanted to add there's like three more coming.
They are.
They just actually were in another show prior.
Well, there's two Lee Krasners. At the Polly Krasner House. The show closes today, so they're coming here tomorrow.
And what happens to the painting that you were guessing who the artist was? It's not on the wall.
We're replacing that with another. It's like always, it's like what we do. It's fun to just evolve.
Who was the artist? Was it Jane Wilson?
We're going to not say anything on that one. But when you see the piece that's coming on Friday,
you're going to see an unveiling
that's truly magnificent.
So to get back to your question, you asked about the expansion. Yes. We wanted to expand out, include more artists. We wanted to include not only the first generation, but the second generation, and its influence into the Hamptons. So we visited, got to work, and we acquired a lot of pieces of footwork, and we're very happy to be able to do that and include them. Now, 32 women, acclaimed women artists of this era, 50s, 60s, 70s, even the 80s, and we've included some great artists just like Carol Hunt, who is a local, lives here in Southampton, great AbEx, came with from really the 70s, 80s, 90s. So we're just, you know, so they, yeah, we want to
build it
there.
And I think that your passion for it and knowing and following what is available and what's becoming available is clearly, you know, your passion in life, really, to fill in all the gaps to get the best work that you possibly can for your collection. I do want to share when I came to Guildhall in 1987,
and then we think about it, and then they got it back. So if you look at that now.
Yeah, we made the mistake of being penny-wise and foolish. We went in there and said, how much are these wonderful Lee Krasners? This is maybe 15 years ago. And so, oh, they're 30,000. My budget was 25,000. So, couldn't do it. So we thought about it again. We came back the following year. So, okay, we got it, 30,000. No, now it's 40,000. Oh, God. We just left and we didn't get it. And all those paintings that were in that room today, now between 500,000 to 2 million. So that's one that got away. The first one that got away in my life was Andy Warhol, actually. I'm the creator of the syndicated TV show Dance Fever, and the MC of the show.
Who remembers Dance Fever?
But anyhow, I created the show at Regine's, and one of my celebrity judges was Andy Warhol, and he would always say to me, come on, Rick, let me do your portrait, let me paint your portrait, and $25,000. I was a kid then, I didn't have $25,000, I could buy a new car for $25,000. So I never did, so that's regret that I didn't do that. In America, I'm probably one of the greatest living women artists. But she started in the AbEx movement here in the 50s and we did all the works and 51, 52, 53, and then mid late 50s she sort of changed and sort of evolved and then in the 60s she created some sort of cultural realism and became a pioneer for behind the curtain, if you will. Manipulate what's going on. They are like they tell me, Rick, we don't own anything, we just a transaction fee, but they're looking at transaction fees and launch transaction fees. So they're always looking for the new thing. So what is the new thing? The new thing is Alice Bailey. They embrace it. How do they embrace it? They put it front and center in their sale. They make a promotion. They really try to push it. They make it over two or three in a sale. They put it on the cover of the book. They do everything to convince the world that you must have it. And you have to do a series of collector events. So they invest in everybody. So now everybody now fighting for the official price. So they are, they're involved in that thing, they're sort of, yeah. And so it's
the trend, such as
when they in the trend, they realize they're always looking for trends. What are the trends? Women have African American artists and trends, both. folklore, and then contemporary. Native American art is actually an emerging trend. So there are, let me just say, there's a saying in Wall Street. There's no such things as good stocks and bad stocks. There's only rising stocks and falling stocks. So if you will, if you look at these stocks, if you will, I mean, if I may, then, I mean, they're works of art, but investors look at these stocks that they can catch wise, but that's great. So everybody's looking for that. So, you know, if one's going to be an astute collector or a collector for, let's say, for profit, one has to be aware of that and monitor that.
I think the galleries are showing.
But the
galleries
are showing.
Because they only have a limited amount of wall space, and they are putting up what they think is important.
But also watch on the estimated price, what the final price is based on the estimated price, because what you'll see is the final price is much higher than the estimated price. And if this happens 3 or 4 times, you have a major trend. That somebody's like, why is it happening? You know? So basically, you've got to be aware of that.
I just want to say one other observation.
Not just us in the room, but a major push in this whole genre is in 2018, the Denver Art Museum did a landmark show called The Women of Abstract Expressionism. And that show was heralded as like brilliant. I mean, Bachman, it was just the greatest show of the year. And I think Elaine Kooning was a painting that was on the cover of the book. It went from there to the Palm Springs Art Museum. And all of a sudden, everybody said, oh my God, I missed it. Oh my God, we got to go back and we got to buy this, we got to invest. And that created other museums, the MoMA, and the Newburger, and the London, and then what was it? Right,
Whitechapel.
In January, February, we just did a show on all the women artists in the world. AbEx women artists in the 50s in the world. I've been throughout the United States all over the world, and they have like 200 artists. So that's a major show.
And that's very true. And again, I would have to say the 9th Street Women, that book alone was on sort of the tail end, which really encapsulated so much of what's happened, bringing names to the forefront that we were not familiar with. I mean, even in this show, there were a lot of names, and I kept telling people, I had never heard of this artist. You know, again, and I know so many of the labs are good artists, but there were a lot of lesser known who did participate. A lot of these artists that left New York City, left the New York area, were not exhibiting locally, were not in the circle, and because of that, they felt felt in favor or felt, we don't know about them. So it's really wonderful to be able to have them here again, and all the research that you've done to bring them to the light. Again, Helen Harrison's book. I want to share that when I first came to, again, in the late 80s, there were artists whose work at that time was selling for $500,000. And then, of course, they were flavor of the month. And then 10 years later, their work was selling for $25,000. How do you account for something like that? There are a lot of artists today who, again, were living artists who are out here, whose work really sold for, they were flavor of the month. And they were top, they were in every exhibition, both here and in New York City. And then all of a sudden, their work is no longer considered. There are a number of artists today who say, well, I can't get a show because I am X, Y, and Z. And that is, it's very true. So what comes to that?
What comes to that? The marketing budget right now, maybe? you got to be careful of pump and dump, which sometimes exists in this world, and which I've seen, happen. I don't from yet, but however, somebody that has reached that level of starting of museum shows and getting something for $300,000 that has lost it has the ability for their right for a rediscovery. Because look at her, she missed it. And then I believe that Jennifer Bartlett is an excellent choice for investments, because I think that she's right to come back.
We travel a lot, going to different art fairs, different galleries. We're constantly meeting different. It's all we talk about. And I think the knowledge, and then actually choosing the right galleries to come to the fair. I think we bring. bring them.
Yeah, I mean, we're always researching artists, living and dead, and see who was, you know, who was, has great potential. And yeah, there's a tremendous number of artists with potential. So even in this show, we expanded to 23 to include some new artists that haven't been in the sentence previously, but we've added them in. So I think that's good because I think that will only serve to help them, help their state. With the Hampton's Fine Art Fair, which we do in July here in Southampton, you know, we're always introducing new galleries and new artists and spotlight artists. We're trying to discover and create excitement for new artists and have them. You know, there's a lot of big buyers out here. So you know, when they come and see and watch and work with influential collectors and curators and advisors, so it can really help their careers. And so it's great to be able to do that.
I know that people have always asked me, and I always shy away from those questions about what to buy. Because my feeling is always, you buy what you like, you buy what you want to have on your walls, you buy what you. Because I was never looking at it from, you know, I never had the money to look at it from. I buy from investing purposes. So I always bought what I liked, what I thought was innovative, what was expressive, what spoke to me personally. Is there anything, and I've always shown work, and people have said, well, do you like that work? I was like, well, not necessarily, but I respect the innovations that have occurred. So is there anything that you buy knowing that it's not going to make money, but you're buying it because intrinsically it speaks to you?
We often have these conversations on what to buy because we go through catalogs all the time. It's like, just you have to kind of narrow down. So we narrowed, for this show, we did narrow it down to the women. But now there's at least some wall space behind my house.
That's a great question. We have, because we get offered things every day, you know, from all over the world, from auction houses, galleries, and so we're always in a quandary. Well, what do we do? We can't buy everything, you know. So what do? Do we go narrow, deep, like this, like go into a sector, own a niche, and go deep with it, and the 32 artists, maybe we go with 35, 38, 40. Or do we go across and buy blue chip artists across the board? I have a friend of mine who has an incredible art collection, and his artists range from Renoir and Picasso to Cause and Mr. Brainwash. And every time I go to him, it's like no juxtaposition. Like, whoa, like, you know, how could this be? But but you know, they're all great pieces, they're invaluable, they're wonderful. So the question is, what do you actually, which way do you go? It's hard, and we actually discuss this, you know, all the time. We're trying, even today.
And even, I think, where the art's located, because of what it entails, if it's, I mean, the story of when you bought from Europe and we couldn't get it, and then you passport, like, so much goes into it. So even looking at where the piece is.
So that's an interesting story. So we went to Costco and I bought it. In Paris, at an auction in Paris, I paid for a fair amount of money. And I said, I paid for it, can I get it? And they said, no.
I said, no.
Well, why not? They said, well, you know, it's a national treasure. It's a national, okay, you can't leave the country. So I said, oh, okay. So they said, don't worry, here's what we do. All the museum curators meet, you know, periodically, like the Louvre, and they decide what paintings they will let leave the country. And don't worry about it, you know, we'll follow up with them. And look, okay, how long? Don't worry. So a month goes by, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months. Frank Weston, what's going on? It's the summer, you know, nobody works in Paris in the summer. So now it's September. It's October. Finally, I get a call in October. Like 6-7 months after we bought the piece. Good news! The Louvre has approved that you can have the piece, we're gonna send it to you, we'll have it in a couple of days. We get it, I was so excited, you know, we get it, put it on the wall, and now we got Picasso on the wall. The next day, I get an email. The National Museum of Picasso in Paris wants to borrow that piece. So we said, are you kidding? What are we gonna do? So we said, I can't say no to them. I mean, you know, I've never been there. I mean, you your GNP is like larger than Spain. You know? I mean, you know, so like, you know, so I, you know, so as we have to, so we actually took it and put it in the back. Abstract styles that are great, or maybe they have a little bit of a different spin and different color variation on it. And I think that they're remarkable and they'll do well.
Do you each have to agree before you purchase
a part?
This I found is a major flaw. Yeah. A lot of people are like, oh, we lost that piece because we didn't agree. So how do you handle that?
We both have different thought processes of how we look at it. I'm adamant about the signature. Adding it, but a lot of people don't sign, so we go back and forth. The same.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of people say, you know, we buy paintings from the back, not the front. So we actually look at the provenance, the labels, the history, where to go, other museum labels, other than that. So we're sort of looking at all that, so I think that's an important factor. But we just, you know, we're always thinking, we're always sort of debating, you know, back and forth, as I said, cities. Observations, and so.
It's better with two people because even when bidding on the phone, like the other person hears the hesitation in the bidding and thought like, go one more, go one more. So I think two people makes it, you know, a team. We're like partners in our team.
Yeah,
in a sense,
you know, we're being on a Jackson Pollock once, and I got sort of, I'm going to get out. I'm going to stay one more bit, stay with you. And I, hey, one more bit, we got it. So it's sometimes that's, you know.
As we're driving.
A little push. A little push makes it matter. But, you know, how do you evaluate your thing? What do you look? We look at provenance. Does it fit into our collection? Will it fit on a wall somewhere? You know, sometimes there's paintings that are a little too large. And, like, yeah, but 50 foot and the painting is 52 feet. Well, what do we do? We can't cover it. So it's like, fold it now. So, I mean, basically, we can get it and we turn away a lot of important paintings because it's just 2 inches larger than the space.
I'm a thousand times this one.